All right, y'all, once again, this is Chauncey, a.k.a. Ukarima, GMOGMedia.tv. I'm here live and direct in Coconut Grove, Florida. Got a very special guest here, Fatima Shabazz from Fanashaa Defined Essentials, and she's here to talk about overall health in a holistic manner, raw foods, vegan, and that kind of thing. So what I want to ask you first is, to start off, is if you can give you a little bit of background as far as how you got started in the holistic health and overall background with raw vegan food and stuff and things of that nature.
Okay, definitely. Well, I'm a certified holistic health coach, and I teach people how to use food as medicine and bring their bodies back into wholeness. What started me on my journey was about, 15 years ago, I had moved to Wisconsin to live with my sister, and in the process of me doing that, I had took on the habits of that environment, which consisted of a lot of eating meats and drinking. It's the dairy state, and it's also the home of Miller Brewing Company. So in Wisconsin, it's considered a norm to have beer for breakfast. Yeah, so I participated in that lifestyle, and in me doing that, I had gotten my body in a very ascetic state. So I spent about 3 years in Wisconsin entertaining that lifestyle, and when I got back here to Florida, I had begun to, you know, gradually put on weight, and mind you, I was brought up on a plant-based diet.
Okay.
Yeah, both of my parents are vegetarian, and
oh, wow, okay.
Yeah, the way I was raised was on a plant-based diet. So when I got back to Florida, a lot of my friends were like, you know, you gained some weight, you know. And it wasn't until I went to the doctor and I got on the scale and I weighed in at 206 pounds. Yeah, now mind you, I've always been nowhere between more than 125 and 140. So 206 was a lot for me. Not only was I 206 pounds, my cholesterol levels were through the roof and I was borderline diabetic. Yes, so that was a wake-up call for me. I knew that I had to do something, and I had to do something fast. So that's exactly what I did. I tried to do all these fast, quick, overnight master plans. I tried cabbage soup diets. I tried to do all of these things to get a quick change.
Right.
And none of it worked. And it wasn't until I had to do a critical assessment of my life and my health, and I had to really look at my behaviors and my patterns and the things that I were taking into my body and really get serious about being healthy. And I made a commitment to myself and a commitment to my child that I would be the best example for him that I could be. I had to get serious about my life, and in doing so, I committed myself to going back to a plant-based diet. By me going back to a plant-based diet, I was able to lose 70 pounds. I was able to bring my body back into balance. And now I teach other people that may be struggling with weight or food addictions, emotional eating, and things like that. I teach them the science of nutrition, how to use food as medicine, so people can live a happier, more healthier life.
Wow. And it's funny, you mentioned that you grew up, your parents are both vegans, which is totally different than your average black household, you know, especially someone like me. You know, we come from parents, you know, an African-American race household. We grew up, you know, eating all kinds of fried foods, you know, chicken, pork, and that kind of thing. And it's basically copied from generation to generation as far as eating those kind of foods, processed foods, and, you know, it's traced back to slavery, eating the foods that that are what they say that are not good to you, but good, and that are good for you, but good to you.
Yes.
I've heard that a lot, especially in my family. Now, as far as raw vegan foods and people eating plant-based diets, there are a lot of stigmas, especially in the black community, that they think, oh, it's white people food. Oh, it's not for us.
Yes.
How do you come across people like that, and how do you kind of change them in the direction of their thinking process? How did that go?
Well, it's quite a challenge, and the reason being is because it's a lot deeper than just, you know, food.
Okay.
Like the old saying says, and it was written, our people perish due to lack of knowledge.
Right, right.
Right? What is that knowledge? That knowledge is knowledge of self, of who we really are at the core of our being. Right? So, if we really knew who we are, if we knew our true divine essence, it wouldn't be a problem for us to eat living food because we're living beings. You know? So I think the core of it is rooted in us just being unaware of who we truly are. So a part of what I do is help people to understand the divine aspect of it. You know, that we're more than just this physical body. That way there, people can start looking at themselves in a whole new light so that they would want to put healthier things in their body, think healthier thoughts.
Now, as far as diets for raw vegan eaters, and people are trying to make a step to change their regular diet, you know, especially someone like myself who grew up just knowing the kind of foods my family knew about, which is fried chicken, fried fish, macaroni and cheese, coleslaw, that kind of stuff. How do you make that transition from eating those type of foods and going into a plant-based diet? Is it something that you have to grow your own food? You have to go to like a marketplace like this? How do you go about changing that kind of mindset for people? You want to make that difference?
Raising awareness.
Okay.
Raising awareness of the health hazardous side effects that are associated with eating processed foods. If you just look at the statistics, not just African Americans, but also a lot of Latinos and just everybody nowadays with the current state of food, especially in this country. The diabetes, high blood pressure, obesity, you know, the numbers are growing in terms of people that are at dis-ease within themselves that turns into disease. So really just raising awareness. I know many people who may have a loved one that may be suffering from an illness or may have transcended or, you know, passed away because of an illness. You know, and a lot of the times people are just unaware of what they're putting into their bodies. They don't know that a lot of these things that are classified as food is actually poisons and toxins. So I like to educate people, let them know, you know, do you know what monosodium glutamate is? Do you know what high fructose corn syrup is and how these excitotoxins, you know, have the molecular ability to seep past the blood-brain barrier and cause damage to your neurons and your central nervous system and your, throw off your frontal lobe. So a lot of times children, they have a hard time staying still and focusing. And, you know, people may have mood swings and all of this stuff is related to what we put in our bodies. But I think the core of it is because we are just unaware. We're unaware of who we are, our divine essence.
Yep, very true.
We're unaware of the things that we're putting in our body, right. Uneducated, you know.
Yep,
so we have to inform, we have to just, you know, to learn. We have to learn, and in my position is to educate. It's to educate people and let them know, you know, what it is that they're putting in their body and how it affects them.
And that was my next question, because you mentioned excitotoxins. You had, on Facebook, you had posted something about excitotoxins, and then when I read it, I was going away because I didn't really know anything about excitotoxins.
Mm-hmm.
You posted it. I did research and found out about excitotoxins as far as what's being placed in processed food and things of that nature. So that blew me away. And that starts with the education process as far as knowing what you put in your body and being aware of it. Now, as far as making that transition over, like myself, It didn't take a dramatic effect to me to make a change in my diet. It's basically, I just wanted to know more about what I was able to do. That's what I wanted to do. This is why I was able to get in contact with Fatima, because of the fact that I was researching and I was listening to a lot of blog talk radio, internet interviews. And then I came across an interview with Fatima. And then from there, I got in contact with her. And, you know, that was kind of like beginning my journey on what kind of different approaches I can take with my diet, and then making my family aware of what they're putting into their bodies. And that transition started a year ago, and I'm still trying to make that transition slowly, but surely. I'm trying to get over to the next step, you know, because in my age, I'm 34, and the thing is, you know, that's all I knew was just fried chicken, fried fish, all of these kind of different foods that my family was aware of. And now that I'm making that transition over to a more plant-based, more holistic diet, you know, my family, we have a blender, and we get vegetables and fruits, and we blend everything now. We just drink it raw, and that's what we've been doing for at least for the past 3 or 4 months. So we're trying to make that slow transition over, and you know, trying to make a difference in our diet. What I wanted to talk to you about also was not only the excitotoxins, but where people live, like in my neighborhood, and people who live in non-affluent neighborhoods. And what's mentioned is the fact that there's not a lot of healthier food alternatives to where we go. You know, everywhere you go, you have McDonald's. Yeah, you have McDonald's, you got a Burger King, you got a KFC, Popeye's chicken. What can we do to kind of combat that as far as making different choices as far as food that we see around our neighborhoods? But is there any things that we can do? Because we don't live near a Whole Foods market. We don't live near a place like this. We have to travel. What can we do as far as taking an alternative approach to getting healthier products for our family?
Well, first of all, I would like to congratulate you for, you know, making the decision to make healthier choices for you and your family. I think that that's amazing. I think that's one of the most wonderful things that you can do, you know, is to want to see your family healthy. So I congratulate you on that. Now, in urban centers, yes, there tend to be what is classified as food deserts. But we have to get back to nature, you know. And when I say that, you can't let your health be at the hands and the mercy of someone else, of a Whole Foods, of a co-op, you know. So I would say we can all start by going out in the yard and, you know, start growing your own stuff. You know, that's an option. That would be the first thing that I would recommend. Get your hands in the dirt and go out and get some seeds, throw them in the dirt, the stuff will grow. You know, so get back to nature. Get in the garden. You know, and if that's not something that can happen, I know a lot of times people may live in buildings or apartments where, you know, you can't do that. There's also things you can do like sprouting. You can sprout things in your kitchen. So I would say get into sprouting. And outside of that, there's farm shares, you know, you have to really research. You have to begin to research and look out and see what's in the community and start using those resources. Find the farmers markets, and if there isn't one, we have to create it. We can't wait for other people to help us become one with ourselves in terms of our health.
Right.
You know, so we have to create it. We have to create those community gardens. We have to create those farmers markets. We have to create those co-ops.
It's funny because, you know, a place like this is how grocery stores started. Grocery stores were outdoors. People had raw foods and different kind of things around. So now you have, when you go around your neighborhood, now you have Winn-Dixie's, Publix, and things of that nature. That's the modern day grocery store. But this right here, in an outdoor organic farmers market, this is how it was back in the day. So this is basically retracing our roots to how it was back in the day. But now, as you know, this is few and far in between. You can hardly find these kind of places. This is in Coconut Grove, and I live in North Miami, so this is really nowhere near where I live. But at the same time, again, you have to create your own resources, just like you said, to get those products as far as alternative foods and growing the things that you need to do for your body.
Mm-hmm.
So what I wanted to talk about also was, like I mentioned, the excitotoxins. That's a particular substance that I was not aware of when you posted it on Facebook, and I did research and I found out how many things that I put into my body throughout the years that I wasn't known about. So for people who don't know, can you explain to them about excitotoxins as far as what they do?
Okay, excitotoxins. Excitotoxins are neurotoxins. They can be natural or artificial substances that that affects the brain, affects the neurons in the brain. Excitotoxins are usually added to food as food additives. So the sweeteners, the flavor enhancers, these are all excitotoxins. Excitotoxins, they have the ability to seep past the blood-brain barrier, the part of the brain that protects our central nervous system. And what they do is they wreak havoc on the system. They wreak havoc by throwing you off chemically. It's a chemical imbalance that they cause within the body. And there are many other forms of excitotoxins. Vaccines, cellular phones, a lot of the chemicals that we may put on our body in terms of hygiene products. You know, these are all excitotoxins. Excitotoxins, what they do is they overexcite the cell to a point of exhaustion that the cell dies.
Okay.
Yeah, so now you have dead brain cells.
Okay. So it's like MSG as well.
It's MSG. Okay. Monosodium glutamate is an excitotoxin.
Okay.
Yeah, what it does is it gets inside of the system and it overexcites the cell to the point that the cell just becomes exhausted and it dies. So that's why it's called, that's how it gets the name excitotoxin. Because it overexcites the cell to the point of exhaustion.
So basically no more hot sauce. No more extra salt, no more putting extra stuff to enhance the flavor of food.
Mm-hmm.
That's basically artificial flavoring.
The problem with excitotoxins is now a lot of the food companies, they have become master manipulators at disguising the names. So they may have 20 different names for MSG, or they may have 20 different names for a parsimony. And if you don't have a degree in chemistry, you may not really understand what these things are that's on the bottom. You know, you have to have a degree in chemistry to even know what it is that you're eating. So the reason why I say we have to get back to nature is because if you have an apple, one that's not GMO,
right.
You have a natural apple or a natural avocado, you know the ingredients. It's avocado. You don't have to do all the guesswork.
Right.
And we have to stop eating for convenience. You know, I know we live in a fast, rush-paced society where everyone's got somewhere to go and have to get to work, but our health is paying for that, for the lifestyles that we choose to embark on. So, you know, just taking our time out to really research what it is that we're putting in our body, love ourselves enough to want to be healthy and have an enjoyable life experience.
Let me ask you, is there such thing as a healthy, balanced diet? So, for instance, you know, there are people who are really, especially in the black community, people who are really resistant to going into a plant-based diet or raw vegan diet. Let's just say they're really stubborn as far as putting down fried chicken and fish and all that stuff. Is there any alternative methods for them to cook that particular food in a healthier way, or they just have to just stop eating that kind of stuff altogether?
I would say stop eating it altogether. And the reason why I say that is because you cannot get life from death. I have this conversation a lot with people that want to hold on to their chicken,
right.
Want to hold on to their fish, you know, but you cannot get life from death, you know. And aside from that, the conditions that a lot of this food is grown in today, you know, these slaughterhouses and these fish farms, this food is grown in the most contaminated, nasty environments you can even think of, you know. So we have to really just think, use some common sense, and ask ourselves, if I have this dead piece of fried chicken, you know, even though it's fried up and it smells really good, am I really going to be able to get life from this? Is this going to be able to sustain and maintain optimum health? We have to ask ourselves these questions. There's no way around it. There's no way around it. We have to get back to nature. We are a natural people.
Now, there's a movie that you put me on, actually. Fat, Sick, or Nearly Dead, which is a guy based off Australia who basically almost morbidly obese, and he decided to make a change in his diet, and he did an all-juice diet. And that showed a lot of positive results as far as his overall health. And he also got somebody else who he found to follow that particular diet plan. That person saw positive results. Now, doing something like that, as far as just doing with this juice diet in combination with eating your proper vegetables and things of that nature, is that, would that be a good start for people trying to just lean off of the regular fried foods and that kind of thing?
To just start juicing?
Yeah, just to go to that, just to go to that route as far as just juicing vegetables and fruits, you know, things of that
nature. Juicing is definitely good. Definitely. But I would not recommend someone to just, if they are a heavy meat eater or a heavy processed food eater, just to start juicing. I mean, if you can do it, go for it. But it's not something that I would recommend to someone that has been eating that type of diet all their lives. I would say slowly and gradually incorporate more living foods into your diet. You know, take out the processed foods, all of the canned foods and the box cereals and stuff like that, get rid of it. And slowly but surely just start incorporating these foods into your diet. Because what will happen is you will begin to reprogram your subconscious mind. You'll begin to reprogram your palate, you know. And it'll be, when you do it slowly, it's a better chance that you'll be able to take it on as a lifestyle change. You try to just do it quick and overnight. I've seen people do that and they get overwhelmed by the process and it's hard for them to stick to it.
Right.
It's to secure it. So I would say for anyone who wants to transition, research, study, you know, find out about, you know, your blood type, find out about, you know, your metabolic rate, find out, you know, just many different things that you need to just know about yourself. You know, what type of work that you do, your age, your lifestyle. Really look at those things. You know, and find that stillness within yourself. Because a lot of times, if we can just sit still enough and get rid of the distractions, you know, whether if it's the environment, the television, social media, maybe it can be friends, it can be the music that we're listening to. If we can just get rid of a lot of these distractions and we can find the stillness within ourselves, your body will talk back to you. It'll talk back to you. And you start to know what you need. You know what you need.
Right. Now, if you can talk about, because that's a lot of misconceptions as far as plant-based diet and to raw foods. I hear people say about, okay, well, if I go that route, I'm not going to get the proper protein that I need, and I'm not going to get the same stuff that I need when I eat meat. Is that a misconception?
It is a misconception because what the body needs is vitamins and minerals.
Okay.
And, you know, I eat a plant-based diet.
Right.
And I'm pretty sure it does not look like I'm protein deficient.
Of course, yes.
Of course. So I say that to say that that is a myth.
Okay.
All of the vitamins and minerals that our body needs, we can find it in plants, in a plant-based diet. It's all there. It would be so hard for our bodies to process and break down these dead animals to try to get some type of nutrient or mineral out of them. You know, you're going to exhaust your body in the process of trying to get something out of it that you're not even going to get. It's a myth. And I personally believe that it's a myth that was created by the beef industry to keep their business alive. Can't get life from death.
And it's funny because, and I'm gonna actually go into the church community, especially dealing with the Christian church, Christian black church. You have a lot of people who are just unaware as far as their diet and their health. Now, the people in the church that I know, you know, they call themselves staunch Christians and that and things of that nature, but they don't really read their Bible because of the fact that within their Bible, there's strict dietary laws as far as what they should and should not be eating. And the thing is, they don't even follow those dietary laws. They just eat what they want to eat. And the thing is that when they want to make a change to their diet and someone points out to them, this is what it says in the Bible, what you should be eating, they're not even fully aware of it. And that's the thing about people who are, I would say, just basically unconscious of the fact that they're in a certain kind of religion but they don't follow the dietary laws as far as what's written. And I come across that a lot with people within that kind of realm. And it falls in line with what you were talking about earlier, with the different toxins, different kind of foods that you eat, and things of that nature. So that's very key to people who are in the church, because I'm also in the church as well. But who's not aware of what they eat and what they put into their bodies. If they read the Bible, they will understand the things that they need to eat.
Well, one thing that I would get from people in the church is they would tell me, well, you know, Fatima, in the New Testament,
right?
It says basically that if you just, God made everything clean and holy, and if you just pray over it, then it's fine to eat.
Oh, no, did I take it?
So I would get that a lot from, people within the church that want to stick
how
to
much
eating,
is the pork?
You know, their pork. Even though in Leviticus chapter 11, verse 7, it says you're not supposed to eat it.
Oh, yep.
You know, but also in the Bible it says that the herbs is for the healing of the nation. You know, the fruit is to be your meat.
Exactly.
You know, and the herbs are to sustain and keep us healthy in terms of healing.
Yep.
It says that.
Exactly.
But, you know, we tend to take out what we want to take out.
Right.
And follow what we want to follow to suit our lifestyle.
Exactly, right.
But also, if you look at the black church, you have a lot of people within the black church that are very unhealthy.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Very unhealthy.
The pastors? Trust me, I've seen the pastors.
Very unhealthy.
Yes. Yes, very unhealthy. Yeah, very unhealthy. So yeah, basically, we're here at Farmer's Market in the Coconut Grove. If you can tell the people exactly a brief history about Farmer's Market and how long have you been coming here and the vendors that are also here as well.
Okay, well, I have been coming to Glacier Farms Farmers Market, which is on the corner of Margaret and Grand and Coconut Grove, 3300 West Grand Avenue. This is going on my fourth year here. This market has been around for about 30 years. It's an organic, vegan market. We have many different holistic vendors. We have everything from jams and jellies to organic, exotic fruits and vegetables, many different seeds and sprouts, things that you won't normally find in your local supermarket. A lot of exotic things that come from different places around the world we have here. We have massage therapists. We have some different psychic readers over here, people that sell bread, natural juices, Indonesian food. And of course here, Fanashaa Shabazz Official, we sell all natural skincare products. We sell natural herbs, detoxes for the body, moringa, the tree of life, different supplements, superfoods. We offer wellness and educational programs on how to use food as medicine and things like that. But it's definitely a wonderful market. I would advise everyone to check it out. The energy is always pleasant. The vendors are very kind. The prices are very reasonable. And you will just love it. You'll love it, and you will enjoy the experience if you get a chance to get out and visit the farmer's market here in Coconut Grove.
So you're here from every Saturday?
Every Saturday from 9 to about 5 o'clock.
Okay. Cool. And you mentioned moringa. That's another question I wanted to ask you.
Okay.
Moringa is something I just came across about 6-7 months ago, and I've been taking some moringa capsules after doing research as far as how replenishful moringa is to our bodies. If you can talk to the people about, because you sell the product, the moringa product, people who are not aware of moringa as far as what it is and how essential it is to our bodies.
Well, moringa, it's a tree. Our moringa is grown in West Africa. The tree is known as the tree of life. It's been known to prevent over 300 different diseases. It helps the body free of toxins, and it helps to remove free radicals. It's a powerful antioxidant. It has 4 times the chlorophyll in wheatgrass. It's really great for building up the immune system. The moringa seed, it has the ability to purify water. And the moringa leaf, which is what we sell, it has the same effect inside the body. It purifies the body and removes bacteria and toxins. toxins. So not only does it remove bacteria and toxins out of your body, it's also a nutritional powerhouse. Our moringa is all wild harvested. It's grown without any pesticides or chemicals. And it is definitely something that I would recommend that people add to their diets in terms of keeping, you know, themselves in good health.
So that basically you could just take moringa and replace any other supplementary pills.
Moringa's got it.
It's got it all, from A to Z.
Yes.
Exactly, A to Z. Good stuff. So, I know you do a lot more outside of Farmer's Market.
Mm-hmm.
You do workshops, you do lectures, you give people exactly what other things you do outside of Farmer's Market.
Outside of the Farmer's Market, I'm available to do workshops. I lecture on health and wellness. I also do healing food workshops, where I teach people how to use food as medicine. Some of the workshops that I do tincture workshops, showing people how to make different tinctures, tonics, healing smoothies, different tropical pies and desserts, full course meals. So I do that. I also offer wellness programs. I offer a 6-month educational wellness program, where over the course of the 6 months, I teach people how to make a complete lifestyle change. So all the education, all of the foods, you learn about different foods and how they affect their bodies, and you know, just the science of nutrition. I teach that in my 6-month education wellness program. So right now, that's pretty much what I do. Yeah, the different workshops, the educational classes, and things like that. And I also come out and speak and lecture on health and wellness.
All right, so if someone needs to find you, just go ahead and put your information out there, your website, all your contact information as far as how people can contact you for a workshop or a lecture.
Definitely. Well, of course, Fanashaa.com, that's the website. And my email address is Fanashaa@gmail.com. That's FanaSHAA@gmail.com. My contact number is 786-603-2291. That is the number to reach me if you would like to set up a health history, if you would like to get some health counseling, or book me to do a lecture or anything like that. I can reach that number. And definitely you can find me on Facebook under Chef Fati. F-A-T-I. So be sure to go on Facebook and check out my Chef Fati page. And on the Chef Fati page, I have all different types of articles that I write on health and wellness and different recipes. And you'll also be able to stay up to date on the different workshops or events or programs that I may have coming up here in South Florida and abroad.
Yeah, I'll have all of that stuff listed on the YouTube page, guys. It'll be listed with all her links. So you can definitely click on the links and get in contact with her as soon as possible. And come down here and visit her in person. In Farmer's Market in Coconut Grove. I'll have the address listed on the YouTube page. You can check it out. She's based there in South Florida. And we're in dire need of a change as far as our health.
Yes.
And our conditioning. Because we've been conditioned for so long for one way. And, you know, it's a slow process. And I'm starting to make that process. But if you have that inkling to change, which is what I'm doing, then you have a good start. And this is the person to get in contact with to help you make that change and transition over and things of that nature. As far as what she was talking about, moringa, definitely the person to get in contact with moringa. She's local here. I was approached by different companies to acquire moringa, and I wanted to deal with someone local. So I found my team here to deal with somebody local. I don't want to deal with any companies that wanted to prophesize off of a tree based out of Africa. I want to deal with somebody with local,
about our moringa in Africa. Uh-huh. All of our products that come from Africa are moringa, our shea butter, and we also sell those in bulk.
Okay.
But all of our products are fair trade, and all of the products that are made, they're made in the village, and all of the women over there, they benefit from everything that Fanashaa does. There's a percentage that goes back to the village in West Africa. Yes, we have land over there, my sister's over there, and you know, we keep it all in the family. We keep it all in the family.
What about our apple?
It's in Ghana.
Ghana. Yeah, because I recently did a DNA trace at 23andMe.com, and found my ancestral roots, which were traced back to Africa, and were traced back to West Africa and parts of Northern Africa. One part was in Liberia, which is on my maternal side, my father's side, my mother's side, and my father's side was West Africa. So it was very, very interesting to find out, you know, the different things in that area. So, taking things like Meninga, it takes you back to your roots.
Yes.
You know, because that's based out of Africa, that's based off your ancestors. Very good.
And that's what it's about, getting back to our roots,
yep.
Getting back to nature, you know, getting back to our divine essence. Right. You know, and really just putting ourselves in a place where we can enjoy this life experience.
All right, cool. So definitely, you guys, check her out in Coconut Grove. She's here every Saturday from 9 to 5. Get in contact with her. All the information is listed on the YouTube page. You can click on the links. Definitely get in contact with her, and she can start helping making that transitional lifestyle change to get to a better plant-based life, getting back to your roots, as you said. All right, so once again, this is Chauncey, a.k.a. Ukarima, with my special guest, Fatima. We're signing out. Peace.